Hello, my name's Silvio Famularo. I'm presenting this talk because I want to sort out what I believe is one of the most crucial questions that we need to know the answer to. That is, did we humans descend from Adam and Eve, or did we evolve from lower forms of life? It's especially vital for Christians to know the answer to this question because the Bible stands or falls on what is written in the first book, Genesis. The first chapter of Genesis states very clearly that God created the first human beings, Adam and Eve, out of the dust of the earth, and he intended them to live forever. But they disobeyed God and sinned. As a result of this, they were destined to die, and so would all their descendants who inherited that original sin, including you and me. Now, if what we read in Genesis is the stuff of myths, then it seems to me that we can't totally rely on anything else the Bible says. Because who would know which parts are true and which parts are mythical? Belief in Jesus Christ especially stands or falls on the veracity of those first few chapters of the Bible. If there were no Adam and Eve, and thus no original sin, then there would have been no point in Jesus sacrificing himself on the cross so that we could rise again to eternal life. If we evolved from lower forms of life and there is a God, he could hardly blame our forefathers for sinning. How could they be expected to know what is right or wrong if they evolved from apes? For a Christian to say that the first part of the Bible is untrue is to suggest that Jesus wasn't always telling the truth, because he frequently made references to what's written in the book of Genesis and clearly endorsed it. Now let's look at the theory of evolution. When people tell me that they believe the theory of evolution, my first thought is, which one? There are loads of them, and they're all still theories. People talk about the missing link. The fact is that there are millions of missing links between human beings and lower forms of life. So many that I tend to agree with the late Sir Fred Hoyle, one of Britain's most highly regarded scientists. He made the famous statement that the chances of life coming about through evolution were about as equal to the chances that a storm in a rubbish dump could create a jumbo jet plane. Let's keep in mind that there is not just one theory of evolution, there are many, many theories of evolution. And one theory that most evolutionists believe is the Big Bang theory. Well, I don't believe the Big Bang theory. I'm being a bit pedantic here, but for a starter, bangs don't start anything. Bangs follow. So what we must be talking about when we talk about a big bang is the big explosion. But you've got to ask yourself, what exploded? Where did it come from? And what caused the explosion? This was no ordinary, simple explosion. This was an explosion that's supposed to have got the whole universe going. Now let's consider the universe. Our Earth is part of a solar system, and apparently there are hundreds of millions of solar systems like ours in the Milky Way, which is a galaxy. And then they tell us that there are hundreds of millions of galaxies like the Milky Way and the universe. The universe is infinite. Now, not only do these planets, these moons, these suns have a special place in the universe, but they're in perpetual motion. Perpetual motion. What caused this explosion? Where did it happen? And of course, this universe is not just a material thing. It's controlled by laws of nature. Where did those laws of nature come from? You know, we had two big bangs in 1945 in Japan. One was in Nagasaki and one was in Hiroshima. Did anything good come out of it? Did any life come out of it? Was anything created? Do you believe that an explosion in a print shop could create a book? Are we to believe that this magnificently, incredibly designed universe came about by a destructive force? The next thing we have to deal with is the origin of life itself. Now, most evolutionists would say that life was formed as a result of an accidental association of atoms during electrical activity. Well, what I want to know is, where do the atoms come from? Atoms are pretty complex things, you know. Just look what happens when you split one. And where did the electrical activity come from? It beats me how life could be created by electrical discharges. To my knowledge, electrical discharges are always destructive. Look what happens when someone's struck by lightning. With all the electrical activity we have in the world today, have you ever heard of anything resembling life being created as a result of it? And if it did, what do you think the chances would be that it could regenerate itself? If there's anything that distinguishes life from lifelessness, I would say that it is the ability to regenerate. Life can only come from life itself. If God didn't create life, then we're left with the only other option, which is that all life started by accident, presumably from a single living cell that came about by accident. Now let's give some consideration to this so-called simple living cell. Well, first of all, there's nothing simple about it. It's said that the living cell is more complicated than any computer ever invented. Though microscopic in size, all its various parts are contained in a membrane and it can reproduce itself. The probability that such an extremely complex mechanism could eventuate by chance amounts to absolutely zero. Common sense tells us that it always has been and always will be impossible for a living cell to come about by an accident of nature. If with all the knowledge and technology we have available today, nobody's been able to inject life into an inanimate object, how could life possibly come about by accident? Now, take a look at this ball of string that I've got in my hand. Do you believe that a ball of string like this could come about as a result of chance? I'd say not in a billion years could it. Not even a couple of inches of it could have developed as a result of chance. Now, if a ball of string couldn't develop by accident, not even over a billion years could a ball of string like this develop as a result of chance, how could a living cell that has life develop by accident? Now I want you to look at this egg that I've got here. Imagine that you were looking at a large rock shaped like an egg, exactly like this, and someone said to you that it was developed simply by the forces of nature. Wouldn't you have trouble believing them? I would. So how much harder is it to believe that an egg developed as a result of a series of chance happenings? Just consider this egg, look at it. If it were fertilized and placed under a chicken or put in an incubator for several weeks, it would completely transform. It would be covered in feathers. It would have a body. It would have hard bones. It would have a beak. It would have wings. It would have legs. It would be able to hear. It would be able to see. It would make a noise. It could grow up and lay more eggs that turned into more chickens. Now, to believe that all this could have happened, and this is, we're only talking about an egg, one thing in nature, to believe that something like that could happen as a result of chance happenings over billions of years is very, very, very hard to believe, isn't it? I just can't accept it at all. You see, evolution doesn't provide an answer to that question, which came first, the chicken or the egg? But creation does. God created the chicken, and the chicken laid the egg. Another curious thing that nearly all evolutionists seem to believe is that land creatures evolved from sea-inhabiting creatures. Well, this is so easy to say, but let's look at the reality of it. The fact is that except for certain types of sea creatures that God designed to temporarily survive out of the water, all others that come out of the water die within a few minutes. Let's get out of fantasy land. To survive out of water, a fish would need to undergo an incredible amount of physical changes, not only externally but internally as well. Turning their scales to fur, skin or feathers, even if it were possible, wouldn't make the slightest scrap of difference if all the rest of the body didn't change also. Not only would a fish need to develop perfectly developed heart, a blood system and lungs instantly, it would need to change practically every organ in the body to survive out of water. What good is a heart without the rest of the internal organs? What use are even partly developed organs? All organs are dependent on other organs in order to function properly. Have you ever seen a creature with a part fin or a part wing or a part scale or a part feather or a part toe or a part hoof or part of any functional organ? To be functional, all organs must be complete. To have a part ear or a part eye or a part nose is of no more use than being without the entire organ. The fact is that all living sea creatures die quickly out of the water because they can't breathe air. Billions of sea creatures, fish, shellfish, crabs, lobsters, sardines, prawns, are caught around the world every month. Nearly every one of them are handled by several people. The fishermen themselves, the wholesalers, retailers, the customers who buy them, the people who cook them, the people who eat them. None of these fish have ever been observed to be evolving. What's more, to survive such a change, at least two of the same fish, a male and a female, would have to undergo all the same miraculous changes at precisely the same time in exactly the same place. On top of this, they would both have to find some way of altering their regenerative organs. Now, evolutionists will say, oh, it took billions of years. Allow me to give you an example of why I consider that allowing billions of years doesn't allow the impossible to become possible. If you add 5 and 5 together, you get 10. If you add 6 and 4 together, you get 10. If you add 7 and 3 together, you get 10. But if you add 6 and 3 together, you'll never get 10. If a million people tried for a million years to add 6 and 3 together and they added correctly, they would never get 10 because it's impossible. Now, if that's impossible, don't you think that it would be more impossible for a fish to come out of the sea and change all its external and internal organs and become a land-living creature? Yet not only do evolutionists believe that fish came out of the sea and survived, most of them believe that some of these creatures did a complete turnaround and made a transition back to the sea. I once read an article about whales in an old National Geographic magazine. It was the December 1976 edition. I remember well that it had a large fold-out drawing of a partly formed whale making its way into the sea. I don't know what I did with that magazine, but fortunately, I made a note of something that was written in the article. I still find it hard to believe that any sound-thinking human being could believe what was written in it. Yet it's commonly accepted as truth by most evolutionists, and similar stories are related in most encyclopedias. This is what the article said. The whale's ascendancy to sovereign size apparently began 60 million years ago, when hairy, four-legged animals in search of food and sanctuary ventured into the waters. As eons passed, changes slowly occurred. Hind legs disappeared, front legs changed to flippers, hair gave way to a thick, smooth blanket of blubber, nostrils moved to the top of the head, the tail broadened, and in the buoyant world, the body became enormous. Did you get that? Hind legs disappeared, front legs changed to flippers, hair gave way to a thick, smooth blanket of blubber, nostrils moved to the top of the head, the tail broadened, and in the buoyant world, the body became enormous. Now, once again, evolutionists will say that this happened over billions of years. But the question arises, What did they eat during those billions of years that they were making that transition, looking for food? Why, for heaven's sake, would those hairy four-legged animals need to go into the sea in search of food? If they were so clever that they could make all those physical changes, why couldn't they find the food they needed somewhere else on the land? All the other animals did. We've been told that human skulls have been found that are over 2 million years old. Well, I don't believe that either. Many years ago, when I was in my 20s and in the taxi business, I was pondering this evolution question between fears. Frankly, the thought that I might have descended from an ape horrified me. From my early school days, I'd been taught about Adam and Eve and how I descended from them. But now this common belief that we evolved from apes was starting to bother me, as did the stories about scientists having dug up bones belonging to so-called ape men who lived millions of years ago. The thought then suddenly came to me that the world's population doubles every so often. If I could work out how many times the world's population had doubled since the beginning, and I allowed a few hundred years for each time it did so, I could get a very rough indication of how long ago the first two human beings were on this earth, whether they evolved or whether they were created. There were no pocket calculators in those days, so I had to work it out by pen and paper. I told myself that if it was going to take me all day to calculate it, I would still do it, because the answer was so important to me. To my amazement, it only took me a few minutes. Guess how many times the world's population has doubled since the beginning? The answer is only 31 and a half times. That's all. I recall mentioning this to a friend of mine who believes in evolution, and he said that scientists have proved that this is not true. Well, it is true. It's an indisputable fact that you can prove yourself. Simply get a calculator, enter the number 2 in it, and keep doubling that figure 32 times. If you don't get over 8.5 billion, get yourself a new calculator. This tells me that if man was on Earth 2 million years ago, it's taken an average of over 64,000 years for each time the world's population has doubled. In other words, first there were two human beings, then 64,000 years later there were four, then 64,000 years later there were eight, and so on. Well, I wouldn't say that that was slow, but a Maori lady died in New Zealand in December 1984 at the age of 112 years, leaving 450 descendants. Now let's get back to Adam and Eve. If they were the first two human beings and lived about 6,000 years ago, as Bible chronology suggests, the average time it's taken for the world's population to double is about 193 years. If the story of Noah and the ark is true, and I certainly believe it is, and the great flood took place about 4,500 years ago, as Bible chronology also indicates, then the world's population has doubled 29 times since Noah and his family of 8 people survived it. That's an average of once every 172 years, which is extremely slow compared to modern times when the population is doubling at a rate of about once every 50 or 60 years, in spite of birth control, abortion, wars, and mass starvation, which still occurs in many countries today. And here's more to think about. It's been estimated that the world's population was approximately 600 million in the year 1650, and it increased to about 2.4 billion by 1950. This means that it would have doubled twice in 300 years, at an average rate of once every 150 years. Libraries and museums throughout the world abound in drawings, models, and stories of ape-like creatures resembling human beings from whom we are presumed to have evolved. For instance, Java Man, Zinjanthropus, Nebraska Man, Hesperopithecus, Nutcracker Man, Zinjanthropus, Neanderthal man, Homo neanderthalensis, and Cro-Magnon man, etc., etc. These supposed creatures are always given Latin or other fancy foreign names to make them seem more authentic. Well, the fact is that all the drawings and models of these supposed missing links between apes and human beings are nothing more than figments of mankind's imagination. The entire fossil bones on which the evidence for such so-called creatures are based belong to either apes, monkeys, or human beings. What's more, in every single case where these questionable fossils have been found, there have also been found fossils that were unquestionably human. So what proof is there that one might have preceded the other? It's said that if all the bones on which the evidence for prehistoric ape men is founded were gathered together, the whole lot would fit into a small coffin. There's no possible way that the few bones and teeth that paleontologists have collected could bring to light the delineation of such things as lips, noses and eyes, or the colour, length or amount of hair which covered the bodies of the creatures they're supposed to have belonged to, let alone the facial expressions many of them are portrayed as having. The Nebraska man, who has been drawn, reconstructed and exhibited in museums throughout the world, was based on a single tooth, which, believe it or not, later transpired to have belonged to an extinct pig. It's been said that if we saw a Neanderthal man walking down the street in the same clothes that we wear today, no one would give him a second look, because Neanderthal men were simply human beings deformed by disease. Java man, they always seem to be men, was discovered by a Dutch surgeon, Professor Dubois, in 1892. Five fossil fragments were found. A skull cap, which Dubois eventually admitted belonged to a giant form of gibbon, a left thigh, and three teeth. These parts were found in an area spread 54 feet apart. More than a year later, he added a sixth fragment, a part of a lower jaw, which was found in another part of the island where he found the first bones, but in layers of earth from the supposed same geologic age. Tell me, how scientific is it to collect scraps of bones found yards and yards apart and then add another bone found miles away a year later and claim that they belong together? Look at this picture of three skulls placed side by side. The one on the left is that of a chimpanzee, the one on the right belongs to a human being, and the one in the middle belongs to the so-called Homo erectus, upright man, which was more than likely a human being. It appears much smaller than that of the human skull next to it, but it could have belonged to a young human or even a pygmy. Digging up a buried skull that's unusual in shape isn't necessarily an indication that it didn't belong to a human being. If you just look at any group of people, it's more than obvious that everybody has a different shaped skull and a different shaped jaw. I'm not denying that ape skulls are different to human skulls. One significant difference, though, seems to be the size of the brain capacity. Apes have smaller brains than humans. And this is often a means that scientists use to assess how close any particular fossil skull may be to that of modern man. But such exercises are unreliable. Dolphins, whales, and elephants all have larger brains than we humans, but only a very stubbornly argumentative person would try to persuade us that they are superior to us. Surely it's time that those who are still searching for ape men got the message. There ain't none. And here's an extremely interesting point to ponder. It's universally accepted that even the smartest of us human beings uses only a small part of our brains, roughly 10%. If this is the case, how did this, the most complex of organs, evolve so far beyond what we use it for? We are told by evolutionists that billions of fossils found buried in the Earth's crust support the theory of evolution. But the truth is that no traces of evolution or gradations from one species to another have ever been found. Even Charles Darwin himself admitted this in his book, The Origin of Species. Read what he wrote in chapter 15. Why does not every collection of fossil remains afford plain evidence of the gradation and mutation of the forms of life? Although geological research has undoubtedly revealed the former existence of many links, bringing numerous forms of life much closer together, it does not yield the infinitely many fine gradations between past and present species required of the theory. And this is the most obvious of the many objections which may be argued against it. It's generally believed that Darwin proved that humans evolved from lower forms of life. And many encyclopedias, including the Encyclopedia Britannica, have gone as far as stating that he actually did. But this is far from true. Although Darwin may have been convinced that we evolved from apes and probably went further than anybody else to support this theory, all his conclusions are based on suppositions. In fact, it's been calculated that in his book The Origin of Species, phrases such as "let us assume" and "we may well suppose" appear over 600 times. Let me show you some more excerpts from chapter 15 of his book where he summarizes his findings. The abrupt manner in which whole groups of species suddenly appear in certain formations has been urged by several paleontologists, for instance by Agassiz, Pictet and Sedgwick, as a fatal objection to the belief in the transmutation of species. Did you get that? A fatal objection. Now read this. Why, if species have descended from other species by fine gradations, do we not everywhere see innumerable transitional forms? Why is not all nature in confusion, instead of the species being well defined? That's a very rational question for which there is still not a rational answer. A bit further on he wrote this. But why do we not find innumerable transitional forms embedded in countless numbers in the crust of the earth? That's what I'd like to know. Now read what he wrote about the evolution of the eye. To suppose that the eye, with all its inimitable contrivances for adjusting the focus to different distances, for admitting different amounts of light, and for the correction of spherical and chromatic aberration, could have been formed by natural selection seems, I freely confess, absurd in the highest degree. I couldn't agree more. But there's also something that Darwin himself suggested that I think is absurd in the highest degree. He suggested that giraffes acquired their long legs and necks by needing to stretch for higher leaves to avoid starvation. If that was the case, why are female giraffes a foot shorter than male giraffes? And how did the baby giraffes survive? If they could pull off a feat like that which requires putting extra bones in the neck, how come they couldn't change their diet? The fact is that most zoos everywhere in the world are able to keep giraffes because their diet is not too restricted. Many would argue that evolution is evident by the fact that everything is changing. Well, I wouldn't argue against the fact that changes take place. They take place in all species. No two people, even twins, look exactly alike. They don't have the same voice. They don't have the same fingerprints or DNA. No two eggs are the same shape, and no two snowflakes have the same pattern. But changes are confined to the limitations set by the Creator. The people remain people, the eggs remain eggs, and the snowflakes remain snowflakes. It's said that there are over 700,000 different species of insects in the world, but no matter how much they differ, they all remain insects. One of the most nonsensical theories of evolution is one that was dreamed up by a famous French biologist and botanist, Chevalier de Lamarck. It's known as the inheritance of acquired characteristics theory. How intelligent people could take his theory seriously dumbfounds me. Take this one, for instance. He explained the existence of snakes by suggesting that lizard-like creatures develop the habits of persistently crawling through holes, as a result of which their legs disappeared and their bodies became longer. Now, surely it would be more realistic to believe that Mickey Mouse and Donald Duck were real characters that could talk. The physical changes that a mouse and a duck would have to undergo to do this would be infinitely less by comparison. Imagine how seriously one would be taken if one propounded the theory that we humans would one day discard our legs because we spend so much time travelling in vehicles and watching television. Champion swimmers practice attempting to increase the length of time that they can survive underwater without breathing day after day for years. Yet have you ever heard of one starting to develop gills or fish scales? If a person took a daily swim every day for 20 years, it would be reasonable to expect that that person would become fairly fit and healthy. But could you honestly believe that he or she could start a process of evolving into a different type of being? Another popular fallacy is that polar bears adapted to Arctic environments by changing the colour of their fur to avoid extinction by extermination. The belief is supported by the nonsensical claims that it took place during intervening millions of years. Well, one can't help asking, if they survived through the millions of intervening years, why did they bother to change their colour at all? And if they were so clever, why didn't they think of moving to some other safer territory? While it might be true that the polar bear had the capacity to adapt to cold weather, adaptation is in no way part of the evolutionary process. The very same polar bears certainly have no trouble surviving in warm climates as they do in zoos throughout the world. If polar bears could change the colour of their fur and could pass the secret of that knowledge onto human beings, they could make a fortune. No human being can change the colour of even one hair on his head. Any person who could unfold the secret of reversing the tendency of human hairs to become grey has untold wealth in store. Scientists will affirm that it's impossible for humans to do so, but apparently it isn't for polar bears. There's a very logical reason why only white bears are found in Arctic regions. The reason is that bears are hunted for food and clothing by Eskimos. Black and brown bears can easily be distinguished against white backgrounds, even at long distances, but white ones are not so discernible even at relatively short distances. Hence, they were more likely to survive extermination by hunters. The same logic applies to other creatures that have survived in environments where the colour of their texture matches their surroundings. Predators would have exterminated the relatives whose textures did not match the surroundings because they would have been more visible. If animals could discard their legs because of non-use, as is supposed to have happened to the lizards, don't you think that men, after having shaved their whiskers off nearly every day for generations, would stop growing hair on their faces? Jews have been circumcising their males for over 4,000 years. Surely if evolution by acquired characteristics was the norm, by now, some of them would have started showing signs of being born with less foreskin. To me, the theory that some lizards discarded their legs because they didn't need them is as ridiculous as the theory that fishes turned their scales to fur as they evolved into land-inhabiting creatures. Look at my bald head. The conditions for growing hair in it would seem ideal. Yet it can't be done, even though hair once flourished there. So how could fur grow in a fish's scales where there's nothing to nourish it? And by the way, have you noticed that human beings are the only creatures that need to wear clothing to keep warm? If we evolved from apes, why did we discard our furry covering? Yet another theory is that evolution occurs as a result of mutations. Well, this too is nonsense. Mutations are errors in the regeneration of organisms and are almost always a handicap, if not lethal. Dwarfs, albinos, thalidomide children, and people born with six fingers or toes are examples of mutations occurring in human beings. While such people generally live normal, healthy lives, it would be foolish to suggest that they're an improvement on normal human beings. To believe that organisms can be improved by mutations is to believe that printing errors can improve Shakespeare's plays. Virtually every few months we read in the papers where some paleontologist has dug up another 50 or 60 million year old bone which is supposed to shed light on the numerous theories of evolution. One gets the impression that nearly all bones that scientists unearth are both several million years old and belong to ape men. Well, how reliable are the estimated ages of these ape men bones or any other kinds of fossils? Do you know how paleontologists determine how old a fossil is? This is how the latest version of the World Book Encyclopedia says they do it. Paleontologists determine how old a fossil is by measuring the radioactive isotopes in the rocks that contain the fossils. An earlier edition of the World Book Encyclopedia explained it a bit more clearly by stating that scientists determine when fossils were formed by finding out the age of the rocks in which they lie. What that virtually means is that if the sedimentary rock in which the remains of an organism is found is considered to be, say, 3 million years old, the fossil is presumed to be about the same age. Now, do you know how they work out how old sedimentary rock is? Here's what the same latest version of the same World Encyclopedia says. The age of the rocks may be determined by the fossils in them. Did you get that? They virtually guess the age of fossils by determining how old the rocks are that contain the fossils. And they determine the age of the rock by guessing the age of the fossils found in them. How scientific is that? That's what's known as reasoning in circles. When one considers that much of the evolutionary theory is based on information from fossil records whose ages are arrived at from such unscientific methods as reasoning in circles, one starts to get a real perception of how lacking in substance the foundations for these theories are. Before we go any further, let's clear up in our minds what a fossil is. Fossils are the remains or traces of plants and animals preserved in rock. There are many, many different kinds. The irony of the billions upon billions of fossils found in the Earth's crust is that while many scientists claim that these support the theory of evolution, they do nothing of the kind. What this phenomenon really supports is the fact that absolutely no trace of evolution has been discovered, since all organisms discovered are well-defined species with no traces of gradations between past and present species. Some people have suggested that the duck-billed platypus of Australia is a transitional form of creature. However, since nobody is able to decide which two kinds of species it's linked with, the suggestion lacks any relevance at all. At the beginning, I stated that there are lots and lots of theories of evolution. Well, here's another funny one. Many of our organs are vestigial. Vestigial organs are supposed to be the non-functional organs that we've discarded since our pre-human days. Evolutionists once listed 186 such organs. However, with increasing knowledge, this list has shrunk to about 4. Even the function of the appendix and the tonsils are now known to be defenses against disease. The coccyx bones, those at the bottom of the spine, which evolutionists like to point out are the useless vestiges of our former tails, serve as an anchor for certain pelvic muscles. If the coccyx bones are removed, one can't sit properly. Now let's give some consideration to the billions upon billions of fossils that are found buried in the Earth's crust. Evolutionists would have us believe that these accumulated over billions of years. But there's something here that requires a lot of very honest thought. If billions of creatures lived billions of years ago, and a good many of their bones were preserved, the earth should be covered in bones several miles deep, since animals and birds are not in the habit of burying their dead. The fact is that most bones are not preserved. They decompose and waste away. Read what a prominent geologist, Carl Dunbar, wrote about the millions of buffalo that used to roam the plains of the USA in the 19th century. The buffalo carcasses, strewn over the plains in uncounted millions late last century, have hardly left a present trace. The flesh was devoured by wolves or vultures within hours or days after death, and even the skeletons have now disappeared, the bones dissolving and crumbling into dust under the attack of weather. For a fossil to be preserved, it must be protected from destructive agents such as the elements, attacked by bacteria, water erosion, and scavengers. Yet things that are delicate and easily transported have been fossilized. For instance, sponges, insect wings, and feathers. Now, there's no evidence of large-scale fossilization occurring anywhere in the world today, so how come it happened in the past? When fishes die in the oceans, they don't sink to the bottom and become fossils. They either decomposed or are picked to pieces by scavengers. Otherwise, the ocean floors would be piled high with dead fish and other marine organisms. So how did the ones that were fossilized become preserved? Fossilization demands mostly sudden burials, such as happens in catastrophes. It can't happen over several years, let alone millions of them. So what's the explanation? Well, consider this. If there were once a worldwide flood, such as the one we call Noah's Flood, wouldn't one expect to find a massive accumulation of fossils buried in the sedimentary rocks? Well, this is precisely what the geologists have found. They've found that the Earth is surrounded by millions of square miles of sedimentary layers containing an enormous variety of these fossils. Look at these pictures taken of some of the world's great canyons. Notice the different layers of sedimentary rock. If the soil changes were formed slowly over billions of years, don't you think that the changes would appear so gradually that they would be imperceptible? But instead, the changes in the various layers appear quite clearly to have taken place abruptly and at various levels. Forgetting what you've been taught to believe, what's your opinion? Would you say that these irregular layers of different shaded compressed earth suggest that the changes took place slowly over billions of years? Or do they suggest that they were formed suddenly, as would be expected in a catastrophe of worldwide proportions, such as Noah's Flood? These pictures seem to provide very clear evidence to me that these sedimentary layers have been formed by a flow of water which transported them and deposited them where they lie. There's no other rational explanation for it. Also, if this great flood occurred, the deaths that would have taken place at that time must surely have outnumbered the number of deaths taking place at any other time in history. The flood would provide ideal conditions for fossilization, so we would expect that the majority of fossils found in sedimentary rock to coincide with the time of the flood. Well, here's something worth noting. A scientist from the Virginia Polytech Institute, Robert Whitelaw, studied 25,000 radiocarbon dates that had been published throughout the year 1970. The samples were of men, animals, and vegetation taken above and below sea level. The results show that the greatest number of deaths occurred about 4,000 years ago. The significance of this is that it's been calculated through chronological data recorded in the Bible that Noah's flood occurred as recently as 4,500 years ago. Let's read what the Bible says about the flood in Genesis chapter 7. In the 600th year of Noah's life, on the 17th day of the second month, on that day, all the springs of the great deep burst forth, and the floodgates of the heavens were opened, and rain fell on the earth for 40 days and 40 nights. Notice what happened first. All the springs of the great deep were broken up. This suggests that great quantities of water had been kept under great pressure below the crust of the earth since the time of its formation and burst forth in the form of great raging streams and fountains. This must have caused tremendous tidal waves, earth tremors, and land uplifting throughout the world, adding to the showers from above and upsetting the surface of the earth. Consequently, this would have washed away the upper surfaces of the raised land to form vast layers of sedimentary rock, which are distributed throughout the world, and it would have rapidly buried millions and millions of creatures. So where did all this water from above come from? Let's read what the Bible says in Genesis chapter 1, verses 6 to 8. And God said, Let there be an expanse between the waters to separate water from water. So God made the expanse and separated the water under the expanse from the water above it. And it was so. God called the expanse sky. And there was evening and morning the second day. Did you follow that? The Bible is telling us that when God created the earth, he surrounded it with a canopy of water above the sky. A canopy which is not there now. Keep in mind that the Bible says that just before the flood, all the springs of the great deep burst forth and the floodgates of the heavens were opened. So it would seem certain that it was the volcanic dust particles and atmospheric turbulence as a result of this that upset the water canopy surrounding the earth, causing it to condense and come down as rain. Now let's look at a diagram a friend drew up for me. It provides an example of how the earth and its surrounding canopy may have looked before the time of the flood. To the right, we notice the heat from the sun's rays penetrating the water canopy surrounding the earth. Now, because the warm temperature is unable to pass out again from within the canopy, it spreads right round the globe inside it, warming both the Arctic and Antarctic regions. This would have created an even temperature right round the globe. The temperature at the equator would have been nowhere near as hot as it is now because it was protected from the intense heat by the outer canopy of water. The Arctic regions would also have enjoyed subtropical temperatures because of the spreading of the heat, which explains why excavation has revealed that these areas were once covered in lush vegetation. With the sudden heat loss as a result of the breakdown of the canopy, the land surface of the Arctic and Antarctic regions obviously froze and became covered in ice. This would have rapidly, I repeat, rapidly frozen the millions and millions of animals and thick vegetation that has since been uncovered in these areas, including animals the size of mammoths and dinosaurs. These monsters wouldn't have thrived in these areas if it weren't for the lush vegetation needed to satisfy their enormous appetites. So if this great canopy of water fell and covered the whole earth, the question arises, what happened to all the water? The best explanation is that it resides in our oceans. It's probable that in order to accommodate the great mass of waters and to permit the land to appear again, great adjustments would have had to take place in the earth's structure to form the deep ocean basins and to elevate the continents. 70% of the Earth's surface is covered by water. In some places, for instance, one part of the Western Pacific, the ocean lies 35,000 feet in depth. That's deeper than the highest mountains. It's been calculated that if the Earth's surface were made completely even, it would be covered everywhere by approximately 12,000 feet of water. That's more than 2 miles high. There's no problem with trying to understand how all this region above the atmosphere could sustain such a tremendous amount of invisible water vapor. The temperature above the atmosphere is exceedingly hot. It's well above the boiling point of water, so there would be no difficulty sustaining it if it were ever placed up there again. While we're on the subject of the flood, let me dispel a common theory that Noah's flood was only a local one. If the flood were only local, what would have been the point of Noah trying to save all the animals? These would have survived in other parts of the world. If God was only going to flood a part of the earth, he would have simply have told Noah to pack his belongings and take his family to some other part of the world. But the most significant argument against the local flood theory, one that can't be overlooked, is the fact that it would have been absolutely impossible for water to have reached the height of even a very low mountain for even a few minutes, let alone 40 days and 40 nights, and not have caused some flooding over the rest of the world. You just can't pile water upon water without it spreading. Perhaps the most extraordinary thing about people believing the many theories of evolution is the assumption that allowed enough time, things move from the simple to the more complex. For instance, matter turns into planets and stars. Single cells eventually become fish that come out of the sea and evolve into animals, which eventually evolve into human beings. The major problem of this kind of thinking is that it completely contradicts the second law of nature. The first law of nature is that you cannot make matter out of nothing. The second law is that things tend to run down and deteriorate with time. Anything that's hot becomes cold. High things drop down. Order becomes disorder, and complex compositions become haphazard. It's patently obvious to everyone that the natural process for everything is to deteriorate with the passing of time. This is known in science as increased entropy. Gardens turn to weeds, cars turn to rust, clocks wind down. Randomness cannot produce higher order. Have you ever known a room to get tidier by itself? Does a car ever get cleaner the longer you leave it? If you left the pieces of a jigsaw puzzle lying around, could you expect them to ever fall into place by chance? You know, the sun burns off 4 billion tons of its mass per second. So is the sun evolving? I put this particular question to someone once and he got very angry with me, saying that there is some source of supply that replenishes the sun to make up for what's burned off. Well, this may be so. I'm unable to say whether it's true or not. But if it is true, are we to presume that this is a result of another series of chance happenings? Or does it suggest that there's a God who's in control of all things? I hope you will have gathered by now that all the theories of evolution are not only based on unsound reasoning, but they leave too many questions unanswered. Does evolution explain how a seemingly lifeless egg can turn into a live chicken within only a few weeks? Does it explain how a caterpillar can suddenly turn into a butterfly? How does evolution explain how an acorn grows into a mighty oak tree that produces further acorns that grow into more oak trees? Does evolution explain the incredibly vast gap in intelligence, imagination, and ability to accumulate knowledge between our so-called ancestors, the apes, and human beings? How does evolution explain the incredible speed within which a human sperm can develop into a live baby with every complex organ fully formed and the capacity for these babies to keep growing till they mature and produce more babies? Please remember what I said at the beginning. If evolution took place, then there would have been no Adam and Eve. Thus, there would have been no original sin. So there would have been no need for Jesus to pay the price for our sins by shedding his blood on the cross. No wonder the devil encourages belief in these foolish theories. This leaves me with one final question. If the Bible is indeed the Word of God, then there is a Creator whom we must one day come face to face with when we die. Because of this, the Bible, which is the only book that explains our origins, confronts us with a much more important issue than considering where we came from. It concerns where we're going. We're given a free choice of either accepting Jesus Christ as the only means of eternal life with God in heaven, or rejecting him and facing eternal life without God. This would be hell, no matter which way one tried to describe it. If you haven't made the right decision yet, I urge you to do so without delay. Jesus is standing at the door of your heart, knocking and waiting for you to let him in.